Vincent spoke when Dr. Nguyen's introduction, and it's my great honor to be here to give my talk at the Institute called JChem Applications in NetChem and Predictions and Data Science. So I divided into two parts. The first part will briefly introduce the previous project I involved, and the second part will be mainly talking about JChem, Institute JChem applications in our MedChem synthesis and prediction. Actually, I only put part two at the very beginning. So Ning told me that not to brag too much about JChem. So I put other my previous project. Hopefully, there is an introduction for the background and people can know that there are some indications for the non-small cell lung cancer patients. And actually, I'm from 2J Biotech, which is funded by Hengrui Group, and not Hengrui Pharma right now. So don't want to be confused, you guys. So this is a drug development process. I think a lot of people here know this process very well. It will take years, almost up to 10 years, or even more, from the very beginning, from the discovery to the launch for a new drug. And it will take 3 to 6 years for the preclinical stage, and the clinical stage it will also take about 6 to 7 years. And after launch, for the FDA approved, FDA granted, it will take 1 to 5 years. As a medicinal chemist, I'm only focused on the this part for the preclinical stage. We all know from the from when you initiate a drug discovery program, then you have a well-validated target. We call target validation or target identification. And after some biologists, a lot of input, they will finally to propose this target as a validated target for chemistry involved. For chemists, you know, we will using modeling and other computational method to design or to pre-design our compounds. And after rounds of synthesis, we will now generate the compounds to test for validated testing. And after cycles and cycles, we finally can deliver a candidate for clinical. For clinical candidate. So what MedChem should focus? I think it's a very simple sentence, the drugs candidate, of course. So for medicinal chemists, we should focus IP and target engagement, most importantly about the potency and the efficacy, and also the ADME property, which is a drug-like properties. We want to deliver the, all those parameters in one compound. So here I will use one of my projects which I lead in AstraZeneca and later is called the Zhengtao farm. It's called targeting exon EGFR and HER2 exon 20 insertion mutations in non-small cell lung cancer. And right now this compound is in this one clinical trial, and hopefully it can benefit to other patients which have those EGFR and exon 20 insertion mutations. A little bit about background. For lung cancer, there are several types. First, we call it small cell lung cancer. It will account for 50% of all patients. And adenocarcinoma from the non-small cell lung cancer, and also squamous cell carcinoma, and also large cell carcinoma. From the target oncogenes in the lung adenocarcinomas, there are a variety of oncogenes such as KRAS, which occupied about 30% of all the EGFR all the KRAS mutations, and the EGFR accounts for about 10%. And also ALK and MET, others oncogene drivers. And from the EGFR pie chart, you can see for EGFR, you have exon 19 deletions and L858R point deletions. Both of those two types would account 85%. For the rest of 50% to 20% is because EGFR mutations are atypical. From the atypical mutations, about 50% of these atypical mutations are exon binding insertions. So those parts, there is no targeted therapy for these exon binding insertions. So among those past several years, people have a lot of big pharma have pursued their into the discovery of exon 20 insertion mutation inhibitors. Other than non-small cell lung cancer, there are many other cancer types also have this exon 20 insertions. But only for non-small cell lung cancer accounts in the United States is about 7,700 patients per year. In China, because the patient population is much larger than the US market, so it's accounts for about 41,000 patients per year. So it's kind of not that big market, but still is a medical needs for non-small cell lung cancer. And there are some understanding of exon 20 insertions in the non-small cell lung cancer since the year 2004 till the past 15 years. People have gained a lot of knowledge on this target and also a lot of treatment for those patients. For example, from the year of 2005, they first identified this non-small cell lung cancer have the exon 20 insertions. And later on, several years, they described the crystal structures of this protein. And using this crystal structures, a lot of publications based on this, and also a lot of TKIs, such as TAK788, which is developed currently in phase 2 clinical trial for from Takeda, and also for that name and Paslo compound. 417. So a little bit about the introduction about exon 20 insertions in tyrosine kinase domain. There are extracellular domain and also intracellular domain. So exon 20 insertions happens on the tyrosine kinase domain, which is in the intracellular domain. From D76761 to cysteine 775. So among those, the most insertions happens from between 769 and 770. And those account for about 50% of the insertions. From structure-wise, the right hand is elucidate the cartoon about how and why exon 20 insertion mutations and exon 19 deletions are kind of active mutations. This is a wild-type EGFR, and it is in the inactive state. You know, there is a C-helix loop. If there are two kind of mutations, which is called exon 19 insertion deletions, deletion 19, it happens here. And exon 20 insertion, it happens here. So you can imagine, if the deletion happens here, it will kind of draw back this C-helix and then form the C-helix in state. They call active state. It does not need any ligand binding to activate the EGFR signal transduction in the MAC-QK pathway. And the exon 20 insertions that happens here, it also can form, make the C-helix move in, and it can make it to the active state. So it's kind of, it still do not need any ligand binding and can activate the downstream. So, people will wonder if the first generation TKIs such as alotinib or we call it ERISA can have some work or can have some treatment. Unfortunately, the first generation TKI do not have clinical benefit to those patients. And it's mainly because there is no therapeutic window for those EGFR wild type and exon 20 insertions. Then how about the second and third generation EGFR TKIs? We know osimertinib, which is called ATD9291. It is a third generation TKI from the graph of the cartoon, you can clearly see the green color is EGFR exon 20 insertions, and the yellow one is the wild type. After insertion, the C helix will move in, and which results the P loop have the conformation change. And the P loop, which is called the inner part of AZD1991, it will have directly interact with the P loop. So it will dramatically decrease the 1991 activity towards exon 20 insertions. But codasinib, which have different call, we call it conductive call structure, it binds to the hinge region, and this phenylring is still under the P loop, but do not have the steric hindrance as the indo piece of osimertinib. So this compound is much more potent than 1991. However, it has some selectivity issues. And this slide I copied from this year's ASCO poster. Another compound, TAK788, have potent and selective preclinical inhibition activity against EGFR exon 20 insertions. So you see, you can clearly see this is a modalinib, which we described in the previous slides. It inhibits EGFR wild type much more stronger than EGFR exon 20 insertions. So in the clinic, people or the doctor will prefer to prescribe TAK788 for those kind of patients, for those treatment. And this is the clinical efficacy of this year and last year WCS LC poster. You can see both the compounds have the clinical activity against EGFR exon 20 insertions. And as mentioned in the earlier slides, because TAK788 have better therapeutic efficacy window, so people will prescribe or prefer to prescribe this drug. Okay, fortunately, in the previous years, in the last 2 years, I developed BZD9008. This compound also have strong inhibition against exon 20 insertion mutations against in non-small cell lung cancer preclinical models. So right now, it's still in, it is currently in phase one clinical trial. It also have other treatment options for those exon 20 mutation patients, such as ADCs and also EGFR MET bispecific antibodies. And but all those compounds, you know, especially the TKIs, have very therapeutic window still narrow. And if you want to achieve high OR, people will think about how to make it efficacy window much larger than the TKIs that I described. And better drug is always better. So for some drug hunters, we may put more efforts on those to enlarge the therapeutic window and make it benefit to the patients. So the next part, I think I will describe those in Chinese, because for JChem technicians, I think you are so familiar with this part. So I will introduce it in Chinese. 第二部分呢，就是介绍一下我们当时为什么用这个喜欢用它的JChem这个软件来做一些 prediction。 那么你可以看到在这个整个的这个 cycle 里面，我们有这个 design， 还有 thesis， 以及 SAR standing， 还有一些 target condition，他们的哪些是JChem 可以做，所以我们发现除了 thesis， 本来 JChem 都可以，然后这个都可以呢，是从 summary， 从某些这个层面上来讲，比如说它的一些 SAR understanding， 还有一些它的 ADME 的 prediction， 还有 evaluation， 以及这个做一些 potency 啊的这个 SAR solving， 所以我觉得 JChem 在这里面来讲还是比较有用。那么这个就是一个 JChem 的我们常用的一个东西，因为其他的 instant JChem 我们没有买这个东西，它也比较贵，所以我们使用的是 JChem for Office。那么在这个界面里面呢，我习惯用的最多的就是两个，一个是 calculation。 还有一个就是它的这个 structure analysis function， 这两个 function 我觉得是对于药化来讲非常有用的。 首先我先介绍一下 calculation 那么这个例子呢是整个的这些 structure 都是在 EC 的 Jack one compound 这个 pattern 里面 extract 出来所以我们可以直接利用它这些东西 那么当你这个双击在 JChem 里面双击这个 structure 以后呢它会蹦出来一个 window 那这个 window 里面你就可以看到它有一些 calculation 那么 calculation 里面有一些这个我们很常见的一些物理参数比如说 log D solubility 还有一些这个 pKa 这些数据都在这里面那么这里面呢我们常用的就是一个 pKa 和 log D 那 pKa 呢你可以看到当这样的一个 structure 这个 input 进去以后呢你可以根据它那个人为的设定比如说你想最大到最这个 pH 范围是什么样的一个 range 那么来介绍呢它会 很明显的一个结果那么这个结果比如说这个 basic amine 的 pKa 是多少它会在这个 graph 里面就很清楚的展现出来所以这是我们经常常用的一个功能那么这里面就希望大家这个注意一下它这个 pKa 的 range 那么另外一个我们经常用的就是一个 log D 因为 log D 我们就知道我们不希望融化物特别清水不希望它特别疏水所以我们需要在一个 narrow 的 range 来调这个 log D 使它在其他的类药性里面更具优势所以我们在这里面也常用了它的一个 log D 那么它的 log D 的 method 这里面写的是 log P 但是实际上它计算的是 log D 因为你要 input 的一些不同的 pH range 所以其实我们后来建议大家用 ChemAxon 这个东西为什么呢我们做了一些对比发现 ChemAxon 的数值跟我们实测的数值是比较吻合的那么这一页的这些点呢就是我们一些实测的数值跟它 log D 预测的数值的 match pair 所以你可以看到在绝大多数情况下它 match 的还是很不错的所以我们现在其实有很多这个在 compound 在设计的时候我们就已经把它作为一个 filter 的工具来盖着我们来做一个 synthesis 所以这是实测值跟这个预测值它误差范围还是很小大概就在 0.5到1个 log 之内所以这个功能我觉得是很不错的另外一个是 JChem Excel 的一个 founder 它这个功能我觉得可能是有些人用的比较多有些人用的比较少那么在这里面呢其实它跟 Excel 其他的一些算法是一样的 那么你在一个空格里面只要输入这个等于号 JC 它会自动的在下面有一些下拉菜单会出来一些它的一些 formula 比如说这个 JC log D 啊 JC log P 啊以及 JC 什么 PK 啊都有那么这个是接近超过200个 function 但是我们其实没有用到过那么多我只是简单的用到一些那么它的好处是什么呢它就很 就像一个这个 Excel 常用的工具一样你只要 drag down 这个 table 一直到你的化合物的最后一笔它就可以把所有的预测值 log D 都给你拉出来所以你就不需要一个一个去 calculate 所以这个功能也是我们经常常用的一个那么另外一个就是它对于我来讲最大的用处就是 structure analysis 那么很抱歉前面那个像我们讲的这个 9008这个化合物的 一些这个 ICR 的 sorting 我其实也是用这个工具来进行那么当时我们是用了一个这样的一个 ICR table generation 的一个过程那么这很简单其实就是说你在这个一个 R group decomposition 的时候这个 column 里面来输入你想要得到的一个 R1 和 R2 的一个变化那么这里面呢你如果想提前做好了一个 Excel table 呢比如说我可以 input 很多这个 parameters 比如说 potency 或者 solubility 或者说这个 clearance 你们都可以把它 input 到这个 Excel 表里面那么当我在选择的时候呢它会出来你是选 potency 还是选 log D 还是选这个 clearance 那么你就勾选其中的一项然后它会帮助你生成这个一个新的一个 file 那么这个新的 file 长得什么样呢就是这样的一个结果首先它在这里面告诉你现在选的是一个 potency 那么它有 R1 和 R2 R1呢 我们在这里面在这篇文件里面它这个 R1的变化是比较多的 那么从这一部分的这个那么 R2的变化呢 它是在这个是 R1的变化 这边是 R2 所以 R1的变化是相对较少那么 那么就是一个 potency against R1 and R2 function. 那么还有呢，你可以把，就像我刚才说的，你可以把 clearance 啊，你可以把 solubility 都可以放到这里面来，然后它可以帮你生成那个 table。这个 table 对于我们最开始那个项目是非常有帮助的，我们做了很多的这个 SAR understanding， 放它在哪个位置是比较精巧的，可以调控到一个 clearance 跟这个其他 layout 性质匹配。那么当时用的最多是这样的一个 solver。那么还有一个，当然你可以把这个SAR table narrow down。假设你觉得我前面那个特别大、特别广，那我们现在看，可以将这个它 narrow down 这样的一个程度，就是说 R3 和 R1 我 further 这个 further 把它切掉以后呢，是这样的一个 table。 那么你可以看到它不同的取代基的变化会导致部分几个影响。那还有一个就是 structure filter， 比如说我做了哪些化合物，我现在看到有没有遗漏掉的一些这个pair， 比如说 combination 我是不是忘掉了？那么你可以在这里面做一个filter 的部分。那 filter 以后呢，它会很明确的告诉你这个你哪些化合物已经做出来了，然后这个就像 Excel filter 一样，然后你可以根据 potency 来去概括你下一轮的设计。那么最后一页就是我们期望 JChem， 因为所有的产品都希望它越走越好，那我们期望 JChem 是有什么样的一个性质呢？第一个，我觉得最重要的就是 less bug。我们希望 more reliable 的这个 performance。我们希望它，我们当做很多复杂的这个运算的时候 ，JChem 不会突然跳出来说啊这个死机了，要重启。 这是我们希望 detect 这个 JChem 要干的一件事情。另外就是一些 more prediction 的 tools， 那么它现在的一些 prediction tools 还是相对简单，就是一些log B 啊这些理化参数。我们希望它能如果成长为像 ACD Lab 这样的一个比较大的一个software， 它可以 predict 一些 cycle 啊 ，predict 一些这个 genotoxicity 啊。 还有一些 herg 啦、hyco 啦、safe EDI 啊、PDI 这种东西，我希望，我估计这个 JChem 也是有这样的能力，所以我们来看， 希望能看到。然后呢，我们希望它有没有这个一些 local 的 database version， 什么意思呢？就是说，因为每个公司的要求可能都不一样，比如说大公司跟小公司，小公司 biotech 跟不同的一些公司之间，它有一些。 自己的 personalized 或者 customized 的一些要求，我希望呢，其实我们，因为你知道，一旦 customized 这个价格一定就会上去，所以就是说，我们希望它有一个 generic version， 就是可以适用于所有的这个 startup 也好，或者说 big farm 也好，或者说就是不同的 TA 的人，那么我们这样的用处来讲，对我们来说可能会更。那么刚才说到了价格，就是说它会不会有一些 attractive price？ 那这个可能是一些像一些小公司里面 price sensitive 的一些 users， 他可能更希望有这样的一个功能，就是说，因为 JChem 如果别人就再好的产品，你如果没人用的话，其实也是没有，肯定没有。所以我希望以后这个东西 JChem 这个很好的这样一个功能，能够真正的造福这个中国的药化这个 chemists， 然后让我们这个 drug development discovery stage。 能够在最短的年限里面，然后我们能deliver出更好的drug给到 patients， 这是我今天的。OK， thank you。